Welcome to Watchtower History.
We will also talk about another anti-Semitic group that was influenced by Judge Rutherford and the Jehovah's Witnesses.
As we've been discussing, Rutherford's anti-Semitic views were the foundation of most of the prophetic doctrines that he was presenting. We've showed lots of evidence over these past several episodes of our discussion with all the documentation, all the verbiage, all the
artwork,
all the things that became a part of the foundation of Watchtower's doctrine. We also showed how Rutherford's anti-Semitic conspiracy theories influenced others, such as Father Coughlin, where Father Coughlin picked up Rutherford's Rothschild conspiratorial letter and republished it in his own magazine, Social Justice, and also his book. And we also have that parody newspaper saying that Coughlin would quote Rutherford.
And we have Rutherford wanting other people like Henry Ford to read his material so that he could be involved in the same circle.
And we saw how Henry Ford influenced Hitler, Coughlin, and others as well. And we also looked at how the Populist Party influenced Rutherford, Ford, and all of these ideas with their conspiratorial ideas. Another one of our viewers has suggested yet another connection, but this time not how Rutherford was influenced, but how Rutherford's writings and lectures and radio programs influenced another organization.
And once again, let me interrupt here, Jeff, and talk about what we've said before. You got to remember that period of time when all this is happening. This is a snapshot, what we're showing, of what was going through the media, through the social media, through the news, through the papers, through everything. So they're all absorbed in this type of mentality and thinking and mindset. And they're borrowing from each other ideas, adding to it, taking away, making it suit with their purposes. Like Rutherford, he took the politics out of it and turned it into a religious conspiracy.
He built his religion out of his political ideas from the populist parties, as we've shown. So Rutherford's anti-Semitism, or these anti-Semitic ideas, we know influence Coughlin and his followers, and a lot of the conspiracies that can have even continued until today. But there's another anti-Semitic group, another anti-Semitic religion, where Rutherford's books, lectures, radio programs, and ideas were the foundation of yet another religion. And this was unknown for the last century. This was something that was just recently discovered. And it was discovered through finding the source of a quotation by one of the founders of this religion.
So it's not Jeff and Paul coming to this conclusion. This is the movement itself acknowledging where their foundation and their groundwork and ideas came from. And we hope you're... We think you're going to be equally as blown away as we were when we read it. We've read it multiple times, and every time we read it, we're still, as we're preparing for this, still thunderstruck by how deep this goes.
And again, we didn't find this. This was found by another one of our viewers. It was another suggestion, and this viewer found it based on the documentation and all the evidence that we've presented for the foundation of Watchtower's ideas so far. And this fit in with exactly what we've been talking about, and it adds more evidence and documentation showing that influence and how far it actually went. Rutherford's writings, believe it or not, influenced the Nation of Islam.
Not Farrakhan. We're going back 100 years now. So we're going to go get in our little time boat again and travel backward and walk everybody through this and show how this evolved.
In Eric Lincoln's Black Muslims in America. And this is quoted in William Whalen's Armageddon Around the Corner, a report on Jehovah's Witnesses. He states that in his study of the Black Muslim movement, Dr. Eric Lincoln reveals that the mysterious founder of the movement, W.D. Fard, used Judge Rutherford's books in his private instruction. Fard interpreted 1914 as the end of the rule of the white devils. This would usher in a period of 70 years of grace before the non-whites would take over rule of the world. His version of the Battle of Armageddon was a final conflict between the whites and the black men, which would be fought out in North America.
Now, it's funny that that should all be that battle in North America, the whites against the blacks and all that. What a lot of people don't realize is that beyond the Charles Manson murders, Charles Manson was a cult leader and a religious fanatic himself. And he believed that there was going to be a war in North America with the blacks against the whites. And in his warped mind, he believed he was going to be the catalyst with his actions that would help start it and initiate it. Now, ironically, with those illusions of grandeur, who else believed that they were going to be the fulfillment of Bible prophecy?
Well, as we've seen here in this quotation, both Watchtower and the Nation of Islam.
The catalyst. And the attack that's going to happen on Jehovah's Witnesses when everybody else is wiped out. It's those cult leaders just have a magnetic personality and ideas and almost an insane energy that draws people to them to actually believe, because they believe it so much. And it goes back to, like I said before in other discussions, relatives and people followed my grandmother because, my God, how could anybody be so obsessed with this and it not be true? And they get caught up in it. And it's the same thing with this. And ironically, Fard got caught up in Rutherford's teachings himself. But he had, ironically, once again, Rutherford's dissemination of what Ford protocols and all the and everything were in a condensed version that Fard could just take and apply toward his own movement without having to dissect it and recreate it.
And as this book mentions, there were similar ideas between Nation of Islam and Rutherford's Jehovah's Witnesses. And yet there's more. So in the Nation of Islam's own sources, Elijah Muhammad wrote a message to the black men of America. And in this message, it says, Elijah Muhammad taught the rule of the devil, the white man, the Adamic race, would last 6,000 years, after which God would come to usher in his 1,000-year rule. He noted that Revelation 14:1 foretells 144,000 believers, but he hoped to beat the old prophet's predictions and convert more people. Pertinently, Elijah Muhammad wrote in How to Eat to Live that a man can live up to 1,000 years if he eats the right food twice a week. Fard promised to totally destroy the white man, including the one you walk side by side with every day. He is the devil, and I am going to destroy him from the face of the earth. Both the Nation of Islam and the Jehovah's Witnesses believe that the believers would survive Armageddon and build a new world right here on Earth. Both groups believe that there is no life after physical death. Both groups believe that Armageddon will be brought about by God's use of the forces of nature, including hail, earthquake, flooding, fire, and disease. Fard told Elijah Muhammad's brother that it was no time to get married right now in 1934, and Rutherford was similarly writing that it was not the right time to get married in 1938 due to the imminent battle of Armageddon.
Two things in addition to the whole thing, but two outward things that a lot of people who don't know beyond 144,000 and all that, and the thousand year, the millennial. Okay. Do you remember? I don't remember which discussion it was, but we talked about Rutherford printed about the special diet. It'll make beer in your stomach. It'll make you live longer, and that's all coming and all that. Now, I mean, here you have it right here, the same mindset and mentality. And even going one step further about don't get married now. Okay, these people really believe that they were going to be fulfilling these Bible prophecies and just jump on board with us. And the contrasts are starkly familiar.
That's what I was going to say. There's so many similarities here with what Rutherford was setting up, and especially his replacement theology, that we're the chosen ones. And because Rutherford was the one taking the lead of the chosen ones, he was the chosen ones. And similarly, Fard in the Nations of Islam, also being the chosen one of the chosen ones. And yet both anti-Semitic as well.
And both had their own organization to be the only survivors of it. In one case, it's Rutherford and everyone who was part of his organization, and still anti-Semitic, black supremacist, if you want to call it that, where only the black race would survive in this one. So everybody's getting all these ideas, their race is superior. It reminds me, and I'm not much of a Star Wars or Star Trek geek, but the old Star Trek, they had this episode where they had, and I think the guy who played the Riddler, Frank Gorshin, who played the Riddler on the old 1960s Batman, was in it. And what it was they went to this planet that were fighting. There was a big civil war, and half the people had their left side black, and the half people had their right side black, and vice versa. And they were all fighting each other because each one thought they were the superior race. And it was good. It was perfect timing. Because remember, you go from this period in the 30s, 40s and all that with Hitler. We've talked about this before. All the genetics, eugenics and all that, building super races, super people. And that Star Trek episode nailed it on the head, what people were actually doing. And in the end, there were two people left. They were on board the USS Enterprise, and the planet blew itself up. And those were the only two left, and they ended up fighting and chasing each other around to kill each other. This is really, you want to look at it, Fard and Rutherford are almost those people in parody in that episode of the show. It's just I don't know what else to say about it.
And remember, Fard is asking his followers to go and listen to Rutherford's lectures. He's asking his followers to read Rutherford's materials. Rutherford's anti-Semitism in the 1920s, as we've shown, was couched in certain terms and phrases that if you didn't know what he was talking about, it would go over your head, such as commercial Jews,
international
Jews. Today they use the term globalists, things like this. Go ahead.
Globalists, all these terms that you were hitting on.
And these were terms that specific organizations and specific people were being called out for being anti-Semitic, even back in the day. We remember that we had that discussion about Rutherford's goal of free speech on the radio. And what are they doing? They're basically reading Rutherford's materials and anti-Semitic diatribes in front of the Congress.
Giving a witness and a warning. I mean, they really believed it. And it's funny. Everybody's just, it reminds me, we said this before, the Australian Royal Commission. When who is Geoffrey Jackson, however you pronounce his name, was sitting there. I'm watching him. And the camera panned in at the members of the board of the commission while Geoffrey's reading from the Bible and talking. And you could see they're all like, Okay, now answer the question. That's not what we're you're here because your organization protects criminals, okay? And you're reading a scripture to them. That I can only imagine that same sentiment going on before Congress. Just say, okay, we got to listen to it. It's the law. We're a free country. Okay, speak. And then just hearing what they had to say.
Now, remember, the origins of the Nation of Islam center around this W.D. Fard. And he claimed to be a reincarnation of the founder, Noble Drew Ali, and his Moorish science temple. Now, information about his background is pretty obscure. And there's conflicting information as well. And he also had numerous aliases. But after Fard renamed his religion to the Nation of Islam, he ended up committed to a mental institution.
It reminds me of Woodworth suffering these, the editor of the Golden Age and all that, suffering these mental illnesses, demons bothering them. You look at these people and they're afflicted with troubles, troubled mind, and they're coming up with ideas like this. And again, why people follow, we've talked about this before privately and on screen here. We just can't get over it, how they get people to follow them so blindly.
In the book, The New Hate, A History of Fear and Loathing on the Populist Right by Arthur Goldwag, he says that Noble Drew Ali, or Timothy Drew, who founded the Moorish Science Temple in Newark, New Jersey in 1913, had authored a text he called the Holy Quran, which taught that the Negroes of the United States are really Asiatic Moors from Morocco. Until they surrender their slave identities, he said, American blacks can never hope to be free. Ali died in 1929. And identifying himself as Ali's reincarnation, W.D. Fard, a former door-to-door clothing salesman of obscure origins, he claimed to have been born in Mecca. The FBI said he was from New Zealand and tracked down some 50 other aliases for him, including David Fard and Wali Farad Muhammad. He founded the Allah Temple of Islam in Detroit in 1930. In 1932, a member named Robert Karim, his given name was Harris, confessed to killing a boarder named James Smith on a wooden altar in his home in the expectation that the victim would be transformed into the Savior in accordance with a 1,500-year-old prophecy. In the aftermath of the scandal, Fard changed his religion's name to the Nation of Islam. Harris was later declared insane and committed to the Ionia State Mental Hospital. Now, there's this mysterious quotation in Fard's Bible of Islamicism, and nobody knew where it was from for over a century. And it was recently discovered. It was recently found. And it was only mentioned in one newspaper article in the Detroit Free Press of November 26, 1932. It says, in the report were quoted several passages from the official Bible of Islamicism, detailing their questioning of Farad, the officer said. On page 354 of the Bible, and that's in quotes, is the following quotation, which was underlined, in which Farad claimed to use as part of his teachings. God is liar. Ignore him and do away with those who advocate his cause. He stated that this was a favorite passage of his and that he used it often in his teachings. Now, according to the Berkeley Institute for Islamic Studies, outside of the mention of the Detroit Free Press, no one has ever seen this Bible of Islamicism. And this article says, like the five guiding principles, notes Patrick C. Bowen, no scholar or member of the Nation of Islam has publicly claimed to have seen the Bible of Islamicism, and there is no other known mention of it in any additional press report, government document, or even in any publicly available Nation of Islam materials. Michael Muhammad Knight went as far to claim that We have no access to this Bible of Islamicism or evidence beyond police claims in the Detroit Free Press that it ever existed.
Do you happen to have the Bible of Islamism in your private collection with all the other stuff?
Well, according to this article, that book, the sources were from Rutherford's book, Deliverance, which is right on the shelf right behind me. And I have two different editions of the book.
Now, just let us take a moment and pause here. And just for the viewers, just stop and think about this. Okay. This book that they're using for this, the Bible of Islamism, and its famous quote, Fart's most favorite teaching, came from Rutherford's book, Deliverance. I mean, what? Why would he do that? Give a comment on that, Jeff. Why would he quote Rutherford, of all people?
Well, remember, this is the time of increasing anti-Semitism. This is the time of an increasing polarization between left and right. This is a time of severe excess in the 1920s, the roaring 1920s, and it was soon to crash. And when it did, these ideas caught on. People were fearing what is going on. People were afraid of Armageddon and other things like that. And so people like Ford and Coughlin and Farad and Rutherford and others who were pushing these ideas at the time caught the attention of people who were looking for solutions, who were looking for answers. And you were asking earlier, why do people follow these kind of things? Well, people like to follow a leader. And if the leader claims he has all of the answers, and it seems reasonable to them, I guess they think, why not?
And Rutherford made himself out to be a leader and made himself a chosen one, as you personally have said multiple times. And here we are. His book is being used in the creation of a whole other similar movement. And again, that's like quoting Ford. That's like quoting the Dearborn Independent. So if you're a Jehovah Witness, you need to stop and think about that. The way Mein Kampf quoted Ford, and all these examples of Ford quoting the protocol and all this, Rutherford's right in there with it. Your religion is right in there with that. When you've got a new anti-Semitic and superior race war being started and all that, and they're quoting a book from your religion by the founder of your religion, you really need to stop and do some fact checking and thought provoking questions and look into your history and the source and origin of what you really believe.
And of course, Hitler and Rutherford are looking at Henry Ford as much of their source, and Ford is using the protocols as his source, and yet the protocols are quoting from a French source, which is a parody about Napoleon III, which is basically a forgery because the Russians took it, as we've shown, and did a search and replace on Napoleon III and replaced with the word Jew.
As so the Nazis themselves believed,
admitted, yeah,
and understood. So it doesn't Hitler, get better than that.
Hitler, Goebbels, the Nazis, the Tsar of Russia, the Russian secret police, American Congress, they've all admitted it was a forgery. And yet Rutherford and Watchtower and the Nazis, Nation of Islam, were using it as a source of what they were promoting and what they were teaching. And yet when Fard makes the quotation, he quotes it out of context. At least when Rutherford did it, he kept the ideas pretty much similar. And so what did Fard actually not quote? So let's look at Rutherford's original source and see what that said. Of Deliverance, it says, "The dragon, the devil and his organization, by its efforts to destroy the seed of promise, boastfully says, God is a liar, and his word unreliable. Ignore him and away with those who advocate his cause. The beast, the devil's organization visible, made up of the commercial, political, and ecclesiastical factors, is saying the earth is for man, and man for the earth. We have the only established forms of government that are proper, and we make the earth a fit place in which to live. Who is Jehovah that we should heed him? Our wealth and our power is our God. In the book, Finding W.D. Fard, Unveiling the Identity of the Founder of the Nation of Islam by John Andrew Morrow, it says, the fact that the Order of Islam was an aberration of Islam was not lost to investigators. They recognized that the Mohammedan aspects of the sect traced to Wallace Farad, an Arabian said to be its founder. They described W.D. Fard's cult as a weird religion whose teachings were primarily one of Mohammedism, with a great deal of pagan jungle superstitions and practices engrafted. Such comments may sound racist, prejudiced, and full of stereotypes, however, they also suggest that investigators had observed that traditional Islamic beliefs and practices were complemented with bizarre ones. It was, for all intents and purposes, a cult, or what liberal academics would describe as a new religious movement. Though Allen believes that W.D. Fard never claimed to be teaching other than a traditional form of Islam, documents found in his hotel room make us wonder the extent to which Fard's teachings were actually informed by Islamic scripture. When they raided Fard's room, officers found what they called the Bible of Islamicism. According to officers, on page 354 of the Bible is the following quotation, which was underlined and which Farad claimed he used as part of his teachings. God is a liar. Ignore him and do away with those who advocate his cause. He stated that this was a favorite passage of his and that he used it often in his teachings. And that's from the Detroit Free Press. While there were several English translations of the Quran that were available in the United States in the early 1930s, the document found among Fard's effects was clearly not the Muslim holy book. Instead of the Bible of Islamicism, it could more appropriately be called the Bible of Satanism, for the citation in question is a basic diabolical belief. Obtaining a copy of this book, suggested by some to be the secret rituals, would be invaluable to all researchers. Who authored it? Why was Fard using it? Was it Fard himself who penned his own pseudo-Quran as Noble Drew Ali had done with his Holy Quran of the Moorish Science Temple of America, which is also known as the Circle 7 Quran? For several decades, writes Allen, Elijah Muhammad argued that the Torah had been given to Moses as a guide for Israel, the Holy Quran to the Prophet Muhammad for the Arab world, and the Gospels to Jesus as a guide and warning to Christians. Hence, he reasoned, African Americans needed a holy book of their own, one tailored specifically to their needs. Although such a book was never forthcoming, it may indeed have existed. Fard may have spoken about it. Fard may have promised to give it to Elijah. In the book, A History of Jehovah's Witnesses from a Black American Perspective, Issues and Answers by Firpo W. Carr, Ph.D. He writes that the book, The Black Muslims in America, a publication endorsed by Muslims themselves and written by well-known Black author Professor C. Eric Lincoln of Union Theological Seminary, says, Fard, an unusually resourceful teacher, was able to utilize such varied literature as the writings of Joseph F. Judge Rutherford, then leader of the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Bible and certain literature of Freemasonry to bring his people to a knowledge of self. All were encouraged to purchase radios so that they could hear the addresses of Rutherford. The book Elijah Muhammad, Religious Leader by Malu Halassa states that though Fard may have embellished or exaggerated the details of his life, the origins of his teachings were not quite so mysterious.
The nation drew its principles not only from the Quran, but also from the Bible, books about Freemasonry, and the philosophy of Joseph F. Judge Rutherford, leader of the Jehovah's Witnesses. Fard's movement also borrowed from such titles as Story of Mankind and The Conquest of Civilization. In The Fall of America by Elijah Muhammad, he writes, theologians, most of them from the time of Martin Luther, who I think was the author of these terms, beast and dragon, especially the late Pastor Russell and Judge Rutherford, founders of the Jehovah's Witness sect, take the term dragon to refer to the Pope of Rome, the father of the Christian church and the Christian religion. Now, Muhammad is partly correct and partly not correct here, because the idea that Russell taught was something that came from the reformers and had been taught for centuries previous. Rutherford had changed the dragon to be the literal Satan cast out of heaven in 1914. And that was in that Birth of the Nation article that we talked about earlier in the roadmap discussion and in our replacement theology discussion. Muhammad continues, this is the first time since we have been lost in this part of the earth that we want to unite the black nations of the earth into one under the guidance of God who is now present. Why should the master continue to deceive his slave? He teaches the slave that he is a free citizen with equality. Why do you slave masters want to hold them? Or hostages? Pray. You do not need them. Your machines do the labor that the slaves used to do. Why not let them go? You want to go war with Allah and the freedom that Allah came to do for your slaves? Before you, a Pharaoh had the same idea. He did not want Israel to go free in a land to themselves. Pharaoh lost the war against Allah and was drowned in the Red Sea. The losers of this war will land in a lake of fire, not water. If white America wanted to free her slaves, she could easily do so. This would be simpler and easier than what she's doing, killing and provoking them through police force, National Guards, and finally the U.S. Army, as we see in Detroit, Michigan. In the book Elijah Muhammad in Islam by Herbert Berg, he says that in addition to the translation of the Quran that he favored, Elijah Muhammad was, of course, dependent on many sources. Instruction from Fard Muhammad, personal contact with other Muslims, and the literature of the Islamic Mission Movement of America, and various other Christian writings and preachers, such as his contemporary, Judge Rutherford of the Jehovah's Witnesses. The borrowing of ideas, interpretations, and methods from these diverse sources, even if verbatim, as with the preceding passage, should not be adduced as evidence that Elijah Muhammad was not engaging in an act of interpretation. He was not merely compiling or manipulating the works of others. Both the act of selection and the act of presentation in a given context are already acts of interpretation. In the white supremacist magazine, The Thunderbolt, which of course was reprinting Henry Ford's International Jew, is a short article, Black Muslims on Jews. And this short article has a quotation from the Playboy magazine that was an interview with Malcolm X. The question was asked, on what grounds do you attribute those isms to the Christian church? And Malcolm X replied, where did fascism start? Where's the second largest communist party outside of Russia? The answer to both is Italy. Where's the Vatican? But let's not forget the Jew. Anybody that gives even a just criticism of the Jew is instantly labeled anti-Semite. The Jew cries louder than anybody else if anybody criticizes him. You can tell the truth about any minority in America, but make a true observation about the Jew, and if it doesn't pat him on the back, then he uses his grip on the news media to label you anti-Semite. Let me just say just a word about the Jew and the black man. The Jew is always anxious to advise the black man, but they never advise him how to solve his problem the way that the Jew solved their problem. The Jew never went sitting in and crawling in and sliding in and freedom riding like he teaches and helps Negroes to do. The Jews stood up and stood together, and they used their ultimate power, That's what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is trying to teach black men to do. The Jews pulled their money and bought the hotels that barred them. They bought Atlantic City and Miami Beach and anything else they wanted. Who owns Hollywood? Who runs the garment industry, the largest industry in New York City? But the Jew that's advising the Negro joins the NAACP, CORE, the Urban League, and others. With money donations, the Jew gains control. Then he sends the black man doing all this, wading in, boring in, even burying in, everything but buying in. Never shows him how to set up factories and hotels. Never advises him how to own what he wants. No, when there's something worth owning, the Jews got it. And so the Nation of Islam is basically repeating what the Ku Klux Klan is saying. It's basically repeating what Henry Ford said. It's basically repeating what Judge Rutherford himself said in the book, This Side of Paradise. The Religious World of Elijah Muhammad by Curtis James Tillerus. It says that because Elijah Muhammad grew up in a world wherein racial hatred and bigotry were as common as coffee and sugar, he was free to express himself in racist terms as naturally and as with much enthusiasm as any articulate member of the Ku Klux Klan. It is no small irony that he came to his maturity in Detroit, Michigan, the home of the immensely wealthy and unabashedly anti-Semite Henry Ford. As I have attempted to show in this study, Elijah Muhammad had no reservations about declaring Jews to be, one and all, sons and daughters of Lucifer. Nor was he embarrassed to misuse the teachings of Jesus Christ to advance his anti-Jewish agenda. Though Henry Ford became a major influence on the rhetoric of some of Elijah Muhammad's most famous followers, this has not been the subject of my work. My interest, as I noted at the beginning, was in the religious world of Elijah Muhammad himself. Nevertheless, Elijah claimed that his teachings on race were not to be understood as a form of racial hatred. It cannot be hatred if it is simply the truth, he would claim time and time again. And that, of course, is similar to the words of Hitler and Henry Ford as well. Now, in this article on the history behind the Bible of Islamicism, you can see two photos of Fard here. One, obviously, doctored and quite different from the other. The one on the left is the original, and the one on the right, you can see, is quite different. And the captions under the photographs in the article states that the book he is holding does not appear to be the Quran. It appears to be the Bible of Islamicism. You can see how thin the book is. There's not that many pages as the image on the right-hand side. The caption under the image on the right-hand side says that not only have his facial features been modified, but the original book he was holding, the Bible of Islamicism, is now much thicker. An attempt was made to change his appearance and the identity of the book from which he preached. The Bible of Islamicism has been changed into a Quran. Then again, what was this Bible of Islamicism? As this article stated, this Bible of Islamism was Rutherford's book, Deliverance. After colorizing the photo from the newspaper, I could see the book much better, along with the yellow title on the cover. I've animated this just to make it easier to see. The book that W.D. Fard presented as the Bible of Islamicism, which he relied upon for inspiration and citation when preaching at lecture halls, is actually titled Deliverance. Not the squeal-like pig from the Deliverance movie in 1972, but the work of Joseph Franklin Rutherford, the second president of the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. Known also as Judge Rutherford, this American religious leader played a primary role in the organization of the Jehovah's Witnesses and their doctrinal development. In fact, he gave that very name to the group
which emerged from the Bible student movement founded by Charles Taze Russell in 1931. The Jehovah's Witnesses, one would be well to remember, are not Muslims, but rather a millenarian restorationist Christian denomination with non-Trinitarian beliefs. According to the Detroit Free Press, the police department revealed that page 354 of the Bible of Islamicism contained the quote, "God is a liar. Ignore him and do away with those who advocate his cause." He stated that this was a favorite passage of his and that he used it often in his teachings. Actually, the citation is found on page 264. A mistake was made by the police department or the Detroit Free Press. Alternatively, a typo was made when transcribing the original newspaper article into digital format. The original quote found in the 1926 edition of Deliverance reads, "The dragon, the devil and his organization, by its efforts to destroy the seed of promise, boastfully says, God is a liar and his word is unreliable. Ignore him and away with those who advocate his cause." The bold print, which I have provided, represents the decontextualized segments cited in the police report completed by Detectives Oscar Berry and Charles Snyder from the Homicide Squad. Millions of copies of Deliverance were printed and distributed in numerous editions. The one photographed with W.D. Fard was printed in 1926, and it has Deliverance in yellow or gold at the top. The cover is dark blue or black and is embossed. In size, shape, and color, it is very much the same book. The dimensions match. The police department or the Detroit Free Press truncated the citation in question to give it a diabolic sense. If this were done by the newspaper, it would be yellow journalism at its finest. The paper had been running stories about black Muslims and human sacrifice. Misrepresenting the quotation and attributing it to the Bible of Islamicism was intended to demonize W.D. Fard and his followers, denigrate black people, undermine Islam, shock readers, and increase sales. It was deceitful, dishonest, and despicable. "Can the devil fool a Muslim?" asked W.D. Fard in the Supreme Wisdom Lessons. "Not nowadays." As Bowen notes, the Tribune Independent, Detroit's main black newspaper, denounced the fact that the Nation of Islam was being persecuted because of white America's loathing of blacks and Muslims. Now, we just wrapped up this discussion about Watchtower and some of the quack medical things that they were into. And a couple of those things were aluminum cookware and a stance against fluoridation in the water supply. Watchtower just happened to be on the same page on that particular issue as both the Ku Klux Klan and the Nation of Islam were. In the Index Journal, June 20th, 1961, there's an article, "Concern over integration causes many to join right-wing militants." There's a statement in here that says, "Besides fighting integration, Grand Wizard Shelton also wars against water fluoridation, a communist plot to poison the American people, and mental health programs. They can perform an operation on you, give you the mentality of a three-year-old, and teach you to be an integrationist or anything else." It also says, "Best organized among this group, and the only one of much significance, is the well-disciplined, racial-religious sect known as the Black Muslims. It preaches hatred of the white man and adherence to the Muslim religion. True Muslims disassociate themselves from the sect and point to a centuries-old stand against racial discrimination as taught in the Quran. Leader of the Black Muslims is an ascetic 64-year-old Georgia-born Negro named Elijah Poole. One day," said Poole, "he met a man named Fard Muhammad, who revealed himself as Allah on earth. And from that time on, Poole dropped his slave master name and became Elijah Muhammad. His group is based in Chicago and is reported to have more than 100,000 followers. The Muslims have a membership goal of 1 million by the end of this year, 5 million by 1964. Muhammad tells his followers
Their ranks will swell as more and more black men, they do not use the term Negro, realize efforts to integrate are a sham by blue-eyed devils, whites, conspiring with so-called Negroes of the NAACP whose real aim is to subjugate the black man. He urges Muslims to fight like hell with those who fight like hell against you. And the world of mankind will respect us as equals, and white rule in the United States will be overthrown by 1970. For all their inflammatory speeches and publications, the Muslims have been strictly law-abiding and insist on a rigid moral code for their members. For example, no smoking or drinking, modest dressed, prayer five times a day. In a syndicated column by George Sokolsky in February 1961, he writes about this group, and it had different titles depending which newspaper it was. Either the forming of cults or even Nation of Islam moves against whites. And in the article, it mentions that the Nation of Islam is a Negro anti-white movement. It is the Ku Klux Klan in reverse. Its preparation is for the War of Armageddon, during which the blacks will overcome the white devils. Call this movement a fake, a fraud, what you will. The fact is that it exists and its membership is widespread. The fruit of Islam, the masculine part of this movement, emphasizes physical training and judo practice. The object is to overcome the weak and degenerate whites. The female membership, Muslim girls training, must live up for the following rules. Do not use lipstick or makeup. Do not wear hair up unless wearing long dress. Do not smoke or drink. Do not commit adultery. Do not use pork in any form. Do not cook in aluminum utensils. Do not wear heels over 1.5 inches. Do not dance with anyone except one's husband. And you can see some of the similarities there with Watchtower's quack medical science, but also some of the Ford, Hitler, Nazi, Rutherford anti-Semitic conspiracy theories as well. And the Huntsville Times, June 21st, 1961, has an article, Thunder on the Right. It says, a self-styled two-star general of the American Republic Army blows up $800,000 worth of U.S. communication towers. We're like the John Birch Society, says Bernard Brous, only more active. Thus, to the front pages this week comes a new name to join the gaudiest group of crackpot and extremist organizations this nation has known since the troubled 1930s. Robert Welch, lord and master of the Birch Society, who sees even Eisenhower, John Foster Dulles, and J. Edgar Hoover as tools of communism, rock-ribbed Barry Goldwater of Arizona, who says, there are some awfully nice people in the Birchers. The Elmore County, Alabama White Citizens Council, which insists that the American Jew is not a white man, and very partial to communist Russia. Robert M. Sheldon of the Alabama Klan, who insists water fluoridation is a communist plot to poison the American people. Elijah Poole, head of the Negro supremacists, who call themselves the Black Muslims. The American Action Council, which wants public office restricted to American-born Christians. Today, alarms like these emanate from the far fringes of the body politic, mostly from the far right, some from the far left. Why? Today, Jules Lowe of the Associated Press presents the first in a series of articles on these extremists, left and right. On page 18 appears his article, Thunder on the Right. Repeatedly, says Lowe, extremist reactions have come on the further shores of American life. If they have seldom shifted the center of gravity, they've certainly produced much sound and fury. His article is one which few readers will care to miss.
And so as you see, Rutherford was looking at the Ford anti-Semitic conspiracy theories from the Dearborn Independent, from the International Jew, and what other populist newspapers were suggesting at the time, and suggesting this global cabal, these globalists, these international Jews were conspiring to control the earth. And yet all of this was based on a forgery.
And once again, what did Farr do? He did exactly what Goebbels and Ford and Hitler and all them did when it was proved wrong and misquoted. They took the parts they liked and they said, well, in theory and in practice, it's meaningful. It just, we just don't have the proof for it. Let them prove otherwise. So here we are, Ford taking, and I wouldn't say an accurate religious snapshot from Rutherford, but taking the ideas, but putting a twist on it again, just like everybody else put the Masonic twist. Let's put this twist in it. Let's put, okay, Ford didn't do that because he was a Mason, but others put their own little extras in it. Rutherford came up with his own little, I like to refer to this, my coffee cup, the Anglo-American dual world power beast. Each one takes what they want, leaves out a lot of stuff, and adds their own. But when you keep pulling the layers of the onion away and you get to the very bottom of it, it all starts from the same source.
And how would you even find these materials? How did they find that Rutherford's book Deliverance was the source of this quote? Unless you could read every book, every newspaper in the world and looking for that exact thing, it would be impossible to find. But now, with all these books and magazines and newspapers and all these things being scanned and available to search in just a few simple keystrokes on your keyboard, it's very easy to find. And it's very easy to show both of these on the screen at exactly the same time and show how they're either being quoted identically or being misquoted. You know, as we saw, Coughlin used Goebbels' speech and tried to pass it off as one of his own. Rutherford borrowed the ideas from Henry Ford. And all those ideas, very, very similar. We laid them out in parallel columns. And Hitler did the same thing.
Now, as we've said before, we had to cover everybody's, why are these videos so long? Why are you spending so much time? We had to get all the proof together. So there's no question about what we're saying. And we discussed replacement theology, trumpet blasts, vindication of Jehovah's name, all these ideas, the roadmap. And each one, as we're going through it, and now we're finally coming to the conclusion of all this, all these pieces are coming together and fitting in, tying into a wonderful knot of what the whole point is and what the whole source is. So thank you for your patience, for one, and we hope you understand why we had to do it this way.
It's like a tapestry. We've been pulling on all these threads. Now we're weaving the threads together. It's like a puzzle. I have to solve a puzzle. Give me a puzzle, and it's just my personality. I want to find the answer. I want to find the solution. I want to find a way to make it work. I want to find out how it works. And by finding all these various puzzle pieces and finding how they connect, it now makes perfect sense where Rutherford's anti-Semitism came from, where his ideas came from, and how he built the movement.
And now we see
that not even Watchtower is not even the only one, that there were other organizations using his writings, such as Coughlin and the Nation of Islam, that ended up with similar ideas.
And the corporate personality of Watchtower. It even defines and shows where that came from. You disagree. You're shunned. You're an apostate. You're an evil slave. To this day, you watch how people, I never realized it was that bad, but you look at the comments from viewers, and again, I'll quote another one who posted something on one of our discussions ago, that we got to condense them. We don't have time to watch for hours because we've got families who are spying on us. I mean, it's the same corporate personality from the Rutherford days. You can't disagree.
And the nature of what this is, and the nature of the evil that has become of these ideas, forced us to deal with it as we have, to lay out all the evidence so that there is no question. We believe strongly and felt that it was so important to lay out all this documentation and all the evidence and the foundations, showing the forgeries of the foundations, to show that the very legs of the foundation of Watchtower is based on these things, and that is a literal forgery, then what is Watchtower? What are the Watchtower doctrines really based on? How can it stand? And so we even see the Nation of Islam talking about Watchtower in a somewhat favorable light even today. And so, although Louis Farrakhan doesn't know the history of Jehovah's Witnesses all that well, he did know the influence of Rutherford's writings on the Nation of Islam, and he's mentioned it on more than one occasion.
He came without observation. He moved among us for 20 years before he made himself known. We don't know to whom he spoke, but he was wise, wise, wise. And in the book of Habakkuk, it said, and he had horns coming out of his hands, but there was the hiding of his power. He taught Pastor Russell and Judge Rutherford. And from that teaching came that which is called the Jehovah's Witnesses, a group of people who understand the end times, who understand the end of this system of things, who refer to themselves as witnesses of Jehovah. And they are right. And what they've set up all over America is called Kingdom Hall. They come and knock on your door to try to help you to understand the book you've been reading but didn't understand. But they represent the kingdom. So do Mormons. So do others. The kingdom of God is a government under the rules and laws of God. You can come as you are, but you can't stay that way. You can come as you are, but you have to be cleaned up and made ready for your job.
So consequently, when he began teaching, he began raising up his people. There were some folks who saw the design. There was one man who was the number two man with a group known as the Watchtower Society. The number one man was a man named Russell, but the number two man was a man named Judge Rutherford. Judge Rutherford, when Russell died, Judge Rutherford took over. It had never been known as anything but the Watchtower Society. But Judge Rutherford, who also was with Russell when they figured out the chronology and that, you know, 1914 was the end and all of that, he also figured out that it was time for the Almighty God to be here. He was wise enough not only to figure that out, but he watched and he figured out where he should be and who he was. And he contacted him. And he asked him, in all humility, I know I'm not worthy to sit at the table with your other servants, but if I can just get a few crumbs that drop, teach me anything. Okay, I don't know how much correspondence they had, how close they got, but it's very interesting. I read a book recently by a white man out of Germany who had quit the Jehovah's Witnesses. And he said one of the things that they couldn't understand was that they had been the Watchtower Society all this time. Then in 1931, Judge Rutherford changes it to Jehovah's Witness. And, he, and, you know, and they couldn't understand that. why all of a sudden they became Jehovah's Witnesses. Who had witnessed Jehovah? Praise to Allah. This is why you'll find that these folks are hard to deal with. Because they have enough truth that their lies are built on that they can fend you off unless you know what you're talking about. They can whip you to death if you don't know what you're talking about. They will take you dead to Spookville.
Wow. So similarly to Rutherford's anti-Semitic influences from the Populist Party, who William Jennings Bryan was his mentor there, and the anti-Semitic conspiracies of Ford, Fard, and Farrakhan, and of course Ford's ideas influenced Adolf Hitler as well. Hitler said he was his inspiration. The Nation of Islam says exactly the same things about the Jews.
The satanic Jews that control everything and mostly everybody.
You are not the chosen of God. You are the chosen of Satan.
I'm talking about the wicked ones in the Jewish community that run America, run the government, run the world, own the banks, own the means of communication. They are my enemies.
Savior's Day is an annual celebration that commemorates the birth of the Nation of Islam founder, W. Fard Muhammad. Savior's Day gatherings consistently feature extensive anti-Semitism and other bigotry. During his keynote address to 18,000 people on Savior's Day, 2014 in Detroit, for example, Farrakhan likened himself to auto magnate and anti-Semitic conspiracy theorist Henry Ford, calling him a great man. Farrakhan used his Savior's Day 2015 speech to claim that Israel and the Jews orchestrated the 9/11 attacks.
And I want Detroit to know we're back to stay. This is a great city. This city gave economic life and stability to America and made her a power through the automobile industry throughout the world. Detroit attracted black people from the South who were tired of sharecropping and allowing somebody else to take advantage of their sweat and their labor, and they came to Detroit seeking a job. Yes, sir. And they started working in these factories. Mr. Ford, a great man who was called an anti-Semite. Oh, I feel like I'm in good company.
Hitler and Rutherford mentioned and wanted Ford to read their writings and commended on that. So we're talking similar ideas. You're not, there's not a separate condemnation of them.
Similar ideas, similar influences.
And as we discussed before, Fard even went as far to mimic Rutherford's style of speaking like a Southern Baptist preacher and encourage his followers to listen to Rutherford. Now, I can't help but recall how Rutherford followed Bryan, William Jennings Bryan. Fard now following Rutherford's style. You find, hey, this guy's a speaker. Let me do what he's doing. And it goes back to, I can't help but laugh, and I don't want to make fun of the man, but what's his name? Stephen Lett of the governing body. Mm-hmm. When you watch him speaking, his mannerisms, his facial expressions. If you were to get to somebody who's into crowd, who understands the science of mob mentality, crowd control, he's doing this stuff on purpose. There's a reason he's doing this. It attracts you. It changes expressions. You follow eyes. You follow emotion. And you stay glued to what he's thinking. And just like everybody else who said, after the end of the talk, you can't even remember anything that was said out of it. You just sat there mesmerized listening to it. So here we go. Fard, in his own way, figured out, hey, Rutherford is a threat. Look, and we go back to that Time magazine article where he made it. Rutherford was enough to make Time magazine for a cult. Fard is saying, hey, there's a guy. He's doing something right. Let me see what he's doing and look into that and apply those principles to build my business. So
remember in that Time article, it talked about how Rutherford dressed like Brian, how Rutherford emulated Brian, how Rutherford idolized Brian. We know that he met Brian at the 1924 Democratic National Convention and reminisced about their old ideas and tried to convert him to his new ideas in Watchtower, in the Watchtower doctrine and things that he was starting to present. In the articles with the press, Rutherford mentioned his connection with William Jennings Bryan. And yet, there's more connections with William Jennings Bryan that we're going to get into very, very soon.
Another discussion for another time. And in this book by Morrow, his findings, I couldn't help but think of Rutherford in this too. As Elijah Muhammad acknowledged, W.D. Fard knew the Bible better than any Christian-bred Negroes. Okay, now Fard used the verse in the Bible and used it as a textbook. Okay, Rutherford knew the Bible better than the average person. And it goes into that saying that's very popular outside the JW community. Jehovah's Witnesses know their Bible compared to the average person. The average person knows nothing about the Bible. So here, once again, you got a guy, Fard, knowing more than the average. You could take verses and tell them what this means, and they're going to believe it. And that's exactly what Rutherford did. This means this. I'm the fulfillment, the temple, 1919. It's just, it's the same magnetic personality.
So as Elijah Muhammad acknowledged, W.D. Fard knew the Bible better than any of the Christian-bred Negroes. Louis Lomax also wrote that Fard was well-versed in the Bible and used it as a textbook. He also reported that he preached in the style of a Southern Baptist preacher. Fard was certainly inspired by other Christian preachers, however. Rutherford was most certainly one of them. Cedric Muhammad, an economist, scholar, researcher, and activist, has gone as far to claim that W.D. Fard actually met with Judge Rutherford in the 1930s. While this has yet to be proven, it is certain that he read Rutherford's writings and that he listened to his speeches on the radio. It is also possible that he attended his speech in person and that he might have met with him at such an event. After all, Rutherford used to lecture to large audiences throughout the United States.
And that reminds me of Rutherford going to the Democratic National Convention to try and convert Bryan to his religion. So these people, I mean, you at the time, remember, speaking, public lectures, that was the big thing. Before, you know, now we just go to movie theaters or stream online and all. People went to public speaking events, and I could see him going to see Rutherford. What's it like live in person? It's like you listen to whatever, the Beatles or the Rolling Stones, but what's the experience when you go to one of their concerts, a live in-person event? And I could see that happening. You go to learn.
If Fard loved the quote from Judge Rutherford and the book Deliverance from which it was drawn, it was because the white devil testified against himself. This is why Fard instructed his followers to read the words of Judge Rutherford, the Jehovah's Witness leader. In fact, he explicitly encouraged his followers to listen to Rutherford. Now, a scholarly journal has described the teachings of the Nation of Islam in a way that it could also apply just as easily to Rutherford's style of interpretation. One of the most important tactics of the leader, and hence of all the group, is the emphasis put on the symbolic character of the Bible and the allegory of the teachings of the movement. I consider this to be the most effective and important tactic of the movement because it works effectively to A, offer a variety of appeals to different individuals having different educational levels or backgrounds, and B, convince especially the ignorant, and all of those members are ignorant, that what the agitator pretends is true. This judgment about the validity of pretensions of the movement is easily reached by reading some verses in the Bible, viewing their meaning symbolically according to the particular perspective offered by the movement. For example, they refer to Genesis 17:8, "And I will give unto thee, to thy seed after thee, the land of the sojournings," as proving that Allah promised them to give them the inheritance of the world. Another example is that, referring to the verse, "Blessed is the nation whose God is Jehovah, and the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance," in Psalm 33:12, to prove their claim that they are themselves the chosen people meant in the verse. To have the name of the God of Jehovah in the verse and not have fard is not of so much importance, as long as the Bible refers to and indicates these things symbolically. To add more evidence for their pretension that they are the chosen people, they declare that the chosen people have been described and characterized in the Bible in Matthew 5:11 and 12 as follows. "Blessed are ye when men shall approach you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets before you. Who is the dirty nigger? Who is more persecuted than us in the world? Who is the coon, the mentally dead, the enslaved? It is you and me whom have been met in the Bible." This is the kind of comment following such biblical evidence of their cause. Such symbolism provides proof for the validity of the divine source of the movement and furnished a bond of union which seems to have a peculiarly strong appeal to most of the members, if not all of them.
It's pretty amazing how both this article here and Time magazine both realized what Rutherford was doing. They caught it. And each one used Rutherford and Fard kind of use their own cultural influence to attract their people, so to say. Of course, black people are going to follow a black leader. White people are going to look for a white. It's just natural. All the races can get along, but sometimes, you know, people are more comfortable with that. And each one went after his own. Rutherford, he practiced segregation. Oh, you could join. You know, but Rutherford would take anyone in who give him money. You know, you're buying the books and selling them. Sure, you come and sit, but you sit over there. You know, and this Fard and all them, they went after their own people and preached their own twist on all this stuff. But the point I'm trying to make is both Time and this book realized it. They saw what those two were doing, what they were doing, what Ford was doing, and Hitler and everybody else. And as we've shown, Brian, William Jennings Bryan, a lot of people, you look at the edit that we've shown on screen, the editorial cartoons that people were making, they were aware of what these people were doing.
And yet, Brian may not have had exactly those ideas, but he also was not critical of them either. He was very soft in his condemnation, especially of the Klan at the 1924 Democratic National Convention, as we've shown. He was not silent in the anti-Semitic conspiracy theories that the Populist Party was presenting at the time, which, of course, influenced Rutherford and the Watchtower after that.
Was it Bonnet that was put in a spot with the Ku Klux Klan? And everybody knew what the Ku Klux Klan represented, especially back then. And he, I didn't know. And you play dumb. And what's he do? He gives them literature. They liked it. They parted happy. They didn't say, we don't like what you're doing. You know, the KKK didn't say, hey, you're a little hard on those Jewish people. And Bonnet didn't say, hey, you're a little hard on the black people. They were okay with what each other was doing. They were of the same mindset.
And as we will continue in our final episode of this discussion of the roadmap, we're going to look at William Jennings Bryan, the Populist Party, and the connections to the Ku Klux Klan and Rutherford, Bonnet, and the Watchtower's reaction to all of these things. One of the ironies of history, I guess you could say, is that the Watchtower lawyer, Hayden Covington, ended up defending Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, who was a member of the Nation of Islam in later years. And of course, Ali fired him because it wasn't turning out in his favor. But it's just interesting how the two intersected. I don't think there was anything, any relation between the two groups at all, other than the Rutherford influence.
I'm going to beg to differ a little bit. Okay. I think it's just too coincidental that Covington somehow was introduced to defend a Nation of Islam member. There's something about, okay, and I'll use an example. Hollywood runs in the same circle as rock stars, supermodels, ultra wealthy. One way or another, they're a friend of a friend who are close, who was referred. So I find it too odd and too close to not say Covington, Rutherford's lawyer, somehow was not in the same sort of circle, pseudo circles with that. That's my personal opinion. Can I prove, or would I make a statement or make a conspiracy theory out of it with a whole other story behind it? No, but I just find it odd that those people run in the same circles.
But as shown, there's no evidence that Rutherford and the founder of the Nation of Islam had any discussions or connections at all, other than the lectures were attended, listening to the radio programs and using the books. Watchtower would not, the Jehovah's Witnesses would not whatsoever even agree with the principles of the Nation of Islam. The foundation of the anti-Semitism, they would, but they're not similar enough that there would be any connection whatsoever in my mind. And there's just simply no documentation or evidence for it.
We don't know if Laura Ingalls Wilder met Joseph Rutherford at the World's Fair. They could have. They were at the same place at the same time. It's just to me.
Or even William Jennings Bryan, who was also there as well. And of course, Laura Ingalls Wilder lived in Missouri, which was a very big populist state at the time, with William Jennings Bryan in the Populist Party. So she could have even met or listened to Bryan there as well. But we don't know. We don't have any documentation for that. What we do know is that Laura Ingalls Wilder was a member of the Populist Party, just like Rutherford, just like William Jennings Bryan. And she wrote about William Jennings Bryan from time to time. Even her daughter, Rose Lane, also wrote about Bryan as well.
Remember, at these events that go on, I'll try and use ultra famous people. Paul McCartney, he's giving a concert. There's a new upcoming singer-songwriter who's just getting his foot in the door and people are starting to like. is he going to get the extra privilege to be introduced to Paul McCartney versus the other 50,000 people in the audience? Do they've got that quick connection to the back door? Hey, this, could you go tell the star in behind the door that this, and we'd like to meet? And that's the same thing that could have been like with that. Rutherford may have informally met with Fard, maybe not to exchange ideas or do anything for anything official, but they could have just in passing just introduced themselves and as two famous people at the time. And Rutherford was famous enough to make Time magazine, and Fard was same thing on his way to creating something big himself. It's my thought.
Well, possible, highly unlikely without any evidence, with the lack of evidence that we have, but an interesting thought nonetheless. But at least we do know. What we do know is both groups were based on the same anti-Semitic conspiracy theories, both influenced by Henry Ford, both influenced by the Russian protocols, and all founded on a literal forgery. What does it have to stand on?